So we are now entering into the last part, as I was saying, of today. This is the presentation of the two projects that were selected as winners of the call for best practices in the field of public play space experiences. In December 2019, the Public Play Space Consortium, in fact, launched a call for best practices. And we actually were aiming at the beginning of the project to collect experiences about how game, digital technologies, serious games, gamification, and playful interaction were going to be used in order to engage citizens in a co-design process and awareness raising process about the public space. We received a very big number of applications. At the end, we selected 30 projects that are included inside our state-of-the-art catalog that is downloadable from the website. And all the projects are showcased in our wiki platform. So we will share now the link in the chat to give you the possibility to visualize them. So today I'm really, really happy and glad to welcome and see finally in directly Georgios, Rolf, and Tessa, who are the leaders of two projects that have been selected. So first of all, I would like to give the word to Georgios. Am I pronouncing your name properly?
Correct, yes.
Wonderful, that's great. So he's going to present his project, which is virtual environment as a technological interface between cultural heritage and sustainable development of the city. And we will then proceed with the work of Rolf van Boxmeer and Tessa Peters, Redzone with Redesire. Thank a lot for being here. Thanks for joining since the beginning our work of in the public play space. And the word is yours, Georgios.
Thank you very much, Marco. Hi, everybody. Allow me to try sharing my screen. I assume you can see my screen now, right?
We can see your screen, yeah. We see the presentation. Okay, perfect. Now it's full screen. That's perfect.
Great, excellent. First, allow me to congratulate you on the organization of this amazing event, and of course to thank you for your kind invitation to join you today. Before I present our methodology to you today, I would like to say a few words about our research. At the Virtual Environments Lab, we work on immersive environments, urban modeling, and digital simulation for the study of built heritage and the creative exploration of historical narratives. We are developing ICT-enabled user-driven tools for social resilience and inclusion with an application in historical context. Through our research, we focus on historic space and the cross-disciplinary nature of the pressing challenges facing our cities, such as climate, migration, and decay, and others, which are explored through externally funded projects, the European Research Infrastructure on Digital Humanities and the Arts, and the JPI Urban Europe, where we consider matters of sustainable and livable urban areas. Our project, which you will see today, is the result of a collaboration between the Virtual Environments Lab and the IAAC labs at the Cyprus Institute with the Advanced Visualization Laboratory of the National Center for Supercomputing Applications at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And all the activities were conducted with the support and having onboarded the local stakeholders and authorities, and specifically the Cyprus Department of Antiquities and the Municipality of Nicosia. Our project exemplifies the application of our workflow, which relies on the concept of people-space data and uses spatially distributed narratives to elaborate and further develop research methods on 3D documentation, architectural modeling, and digital heritage for user engagement and urban transformation. These are the concepts of our methodology together, in addition to the application of immersion technologies, which I believe are relevant to the broader discourse today on playful approaches to urban co-design and management. Specifically, the scope of the research I will be presenting today is to contribute a new means of interaction, a stage of dialogue for local groups, experts, and stakeholders about the reactivation and transformation of public space with a special interest in heritage spaces. We do so by using design and co-creation process as a mechanism of engagement. Our project started looking at the pedestrian circulation around the historic core of Nicosia and focused specifically in the neighborhood of the Paphos Gate, where is located one of the three medieval gates of the city and where the buffer zone almost disappears and becomes a thin line. The neighborhood is characterized by a dense architectural palimpsest that includes Frankish, Venetian, Ottoman, and colonial built heritage, as well as architecture of the recent past, before and after the war that divided the island in two. As you can see in the photograph, which depicts how the site is, the specific site is today, there is a fragmented experience of the space, which is a highly important heritage site that raises issues of conflict and difficult heritage, as it's called, that is not integrated in the urban fabric, nor it allows visitors to understand and appreciate its history. Another important aspect of the site today, which of course it was taken into consideration by us, and it was one of the reasons why we selected to focus on this site, is that the neighborhood is home to a lot of migrant families and one of the most multicultural areas of the city. With our methodology, we aim to study heritage within its contemporary urban environment and in consideration with the latter's needs and characteristics. Our engagement with the history of the site started when we were invited by the Department of Antiquities back in 2014 to 3D document and study the spatial aspects of the excavation. Here you see the layers of civic infrastructure, like the water and sewage networks that were unearthed by the archaeological excavation, including significant artifacts, such as one of the two city aqueducts built by the Ottomans, the first Venetian bridge on the island, and important Frankish architectural parts in secondary use. After the visualization of the current conditions and based on archival research, we modeled and simulated past conditions of the site. For example, how it was in the 50s during the British rule, when parts of the Ottoman interventions on the Venetian architecture were still visible. This allowed visitors and inhabitants of the area to explore virtually the spatial organization of the site, experience its historical transformations, and to discover the changes of the surrounding urban fabric. After we completed the virtual reconstruction of the wider neighborhood, we organized a training school in the context of the cost action and invited participants with background in architecture, history, planning, social sciences, and others from more than 12 countries who worked together with local inhabitants as well as representatives of the stakeholders and authorities, such as the municipality, the Department of Antiquities, Nicosia Master Plan, and Europa Nostra, to discuss about the reactivation of the mold of the medieval walls, and to visit both the physical and virtual sites of the Paphos Gate. And here's a photo of some evaluation sessions during the training school after we would return from the on-site exploration of the space. During this session, the visitors were able to draw a path through the site that had just visited and experience walking through their suggested route in the virtual environment. Our design aim was to propose a more uniformly distributed walking and visiting experience through the archaeological site, one that would be short enough for locals to use it every day, but interesting and rich for first-time visitors too. Our environment enabled us to observe the study and study visitors' behavior in the virtual space, as you can see here, where the visitor would walk through the site, where they would stop, what they would look and observe, how close and how much time they would spend observing a specific archaeological artifact, which are all of which are marked with the red crosses on the plan that you see on the screen. Running several iterations of the process, we eventually developed a final architectural design proposal for the reintegration of the site in the pedestrian movement in the neighborhood. And you can see here an excerpt from the experience from the head mount display of the user, of the visitor of the virtual environment, exploring the historic neighborhood. I can scroll, we can move forward. Exploring the archaeological excavation and discovering how the various designs of the working platforms through the site would allow them or not to explore the site as it was in their first experience. Contextualized in a regeneration mandate that is about mobilizing citizen involvement, engaging communities, and eventually enabling social groups to participate in the reactivation of neglected heritage and public spaces, we were very pleased to see that the special reporter of the United Nations in the field of cultural rights mentions in her report to the Human Rights Council of the United Nations General Assembly our research as the only effort in the country that recognizes the diversity of narratives about and relationships with cultural heritage. And significantly, by using the produced virtual environment to promote the idea to the authorities, who, as I mentioned, were involved in this from the beginning, we achieved to have tacit results and impact on the city. After 3 years since the design of the process, through their virtual experience of the proposed concept, the Ministry of Public Works, the Department of Antiquities, and the municipality agreed to fund the proposed intervention. And following the recent public procurement of the project, it is now scheduled to be delivered by the contractor who won the tender by the end of this year. This methodology we intend to apply to other neglected heritage sites around the historic and divided city. And we have already created a time machine for the most significant historic sites, an interactive application that was included already in the permanent exhibition of the Municipal Museum of the city, and which functioned for us as a first step to join the European network of time machine with our local time machine of Nicosia, in the context of which we hope, of course, to have the opportunity to further develop our methods and expand the features of our digital tools. And with this, I would like to thank you for listening, and I will be available for any questions you might have.
Thank you, Georgios. Thank you very much. We, of course, I keep inviting the public to share their questions in the Q&A, and so we can have some Q&A question and answers after the presentation also of the second project, Redesire. I invite Rolf and Tessa to share their screen and open the mic. Thank you, Georgios, again.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Can you hear us?
We can hear you perfectly.
Yeah, great, thank you. Okay, first off, very happy to be part of this symposium and also very happy to be one of the winners. So great to be here. Let's see how to start, share my screen. Okay, let's see. Is this visible?
Yeah, we see perfectly.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so we are Tessa Peters and Rolf van Boxmeer from the Netherlands. We have a design agency called Rezone. We focus on designing urban concepts, not for the people, but with the people. So we think it's very important if you design parts of the urban context that you do that with people and not for the people. So we try to focus on innovative and co-creative design processes. These are some of our projects. In top left, you see an interactive pavilion that scans the sentiment of the city. Down left is a game about vacancy. Top right is a picture of a do-it-yourself home settlement we created in our city. And down right is the game Redesire we are going to discuss a bit more today. So Redesire, it's a cooperative multiplayer game about urban development. It's an urban management game. You play it on tablets at a table. It's for us always very important to have a digital part, but also a physical part that you can actually play with the people, but have the advantages of digital technology, but also the co-creation with the people in physical presence. So what were the important starting points for this game? We always start with our projects with some kind of social issue. So urban development a lot of times people are not quite happy how they can participate in urban developments. So that was a very important aspect for us to create this game. Improving the processes behind area developments and urban developments. That's more about that developments are mostly created by professionals in a top-down way, and we wanted to reverse that process. We always think it's very important when you create projects that you don't do that by yourself, but you do that with people. Also, the creating of the project and the making of that, you always actively attract other stakeholders to make this project. Acquiring budgets, of course, we had some funding for this game. And we created this game with an actual case. So we didn't create this game in a room closed off from everything, but we had an actual case where we could test this game. And with a kind of sort of iterative process, we created this game step by step to what it is now. We had two important design concepts for our game. With this slide, we wanted to show that what is important starting design principle for the game is that the map is not the territory. So for professionals, city is created by plans, by bricks, by dimensions, by construction. And if you ask people about city, it's not about plans, but it's about stories. It's about how people interact in a city. So that was a very important starting point, that it should focus on the stories and not on the plans. This is also another important design aspect, is the difference between the design promise and the user desire. So if I can speak for the Netherlands, you fly in the professionals, they create a plan, they build it, and then the professionals leave, and then it's for the users. And a lot of times that is a kind of mismatch, and we wanted to do something also about that.
So what are the principles of Redesire? It is an interactive tool to safely bring various stakeholders to the table. It provides a common language to professional, non-professionals, and locals to communicate on an equal base. A game has a common goal, but also a personal goal for better organic progress. The game has a fun factor to break the ice. And because the game is designed in an abstract way, it can be used safely at an early stage. It provides quick insight into the needs, motivations, and wishes of stakeholders, including how they are in the game. By two outputs, a blueprint of needs, wishes, and conflicts of personal game outputs. So now we want to show a little movie about the game. So we stop sharing this screen and we will share another screen with the movie.
Let's see. Sorry, just a minute.
Take your time, it's normal.
Yeah. Let's see, I think I can share it now. Yeah.
There is.
So this is a short demo about the game, and it's about a plot in our city where in the park where a new development must come, but it's not sure what it should be.
We cannot hear the sound. I don't know if it was just the background or it's...
It has sound.
Yeah, we cannot hear it. It's probably due to the... When you share your screen, you should have clicked on share sound. But if it's only a sound background music...
It's sound background. It's not...
So it's perfect.
Yeah. Okay.
Sorry for the interruption.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, so we get back to our presentation now.
So we will explain a little bit more what you just saw in the little movie. So how the gameplay works.
Okay, that would be great.
So here's our presentation again. Can we full screen? So you can start in the game to choose the language, English or Dutch. Mm-hmm. When you start with the game, you can go back to a game idea from a previous game. So you can always go back and game you played 5 days ago, or you can play another game with join and start and join and wait and join and start. Join and start is the turn leader, and he will get to start the game. You are start to get to choose a role. For the best is that the people who are on the table are really the role that you can see here. So kind of like the government, the citizen, the investor, developer, or user. But we can change the roles in every game from every case that what is needed.
And, yeah, we have seen in the video.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Great.
Okay. Yeah, it's too long.
No, it's we are running a bit out of time, but I think that this also was shown very, very well and clearly in the video.
Okay. So I'll go a little bit further than the fun game. This is the gameplay. But the most important part is the black box or how the game works with the Jane Jacobs model. That was not on the movie, so maybe we can explain a little bit about that.
Yeah. So what's important about this game is that you play for yourself, but you also play for the general quality of the city. And who is there to judge what is a good city? And we chose that Jane Jacobs, an urban planner, should decide if this is a good city. And we chose Jane Jacobs because she valued a city not from top down, but from bottom up, from how the user experiences a city. So Jane Jacobs wrote a book, and everybody probably knows it. There are four important aspects that we calculated in the game. So we try to make these four parts an important part of valuing what people are doing. So also the city is judged by how people judge it by beauty, usefulness, feasibility, and special combos. But that's an extra. So the basic is that it is a Jane Jacobs model. So these are four important aspects of Jane Jacobs. So that's a mix of primary uses. So if you add a function that's not there, it will be valued better. Short blocks, difficult to make it more. How do you put this in a game about words? What we did is that we added amounts of people to functions. So if you add functions that attract a lot of people, density becomes higher and it's valued better. Age buildings, if you choose function that use all the buildings with lesser costs, it's better. And so also the density. And this is all kind of the black box of this game that add value to that you together create a better city. This is a more explanation how this is made to work in the game. The red words are tags that we added to the words that you play in this game. So in the end, Jane Jacobs recaps and adds who played best and what should be the best game function for this game. And it adds a personal judgment. The idea is that if you have problematic urban processes, that's often because one of the stakeholders is kind of holding his cards before his shoulder and is kind of negative. And this negative vibe from stakeholders, you want to bring to the top so that people know that they are kind of not working with it. So that's what we try to visualize with this aspect. And in this case, the developer win. And this is the end result of the map of desires, what people want. How bigger the word, how bigger the desire. The color explains a bit about what the sentiment about the function is. So you get a kind of really good programmatic visualization of really soft desires. And I think that's about it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So Rolf, Tessa, and also Georgios, thanks a lot for sharing your projects. I think it's wonderful to see, again, variety. We selected this project at the beginning of the Public Play Space project. One is more dealing with the experience mediated through the technological interaction and the digital device, such as virtual reality, while the others is more focused on the digital interface and mechanics surrounding it. There is something that I actually would like to ask you, starting from the question that it's written in the Q&A tab, that was only for Tessa and Rolf, and asking about the possibility to play your game online. But I would like to build a bit on that, sending this question also to Georgios. One of the possibilities, the project of Redesire, we have seen the importance of interaction, the importance of collaboration, which is the characteristic of a community, no? This kind of interaction, this is for Georgios, how do you think also that in the project and in the future iteration, a further level of interaction do you think could facilitate and give more value to the project through the virtual reality itself? And also for Rolf and Tessa, about the possibility, the question is related to the place where the game is played. Do you think that an interaction that could take place online would have the same value of an interaction that takes place in a physical encounter in the same room? So I don't know who wants to answer first.
Yeah, so maybe we can...
Go ahead.
Yeah. As you want.
Yeah, so for us, it was very important that we have a physical and a digital aspect, but I somehow maybe understand the question because of all these new teams, and it could be useful to play it completely digital. For us, it's the physical aspect in combination with the digital aspect, well, very important. So you can talk to each other on a second level and exchange words about it. And so for us, it's very important.
Yeah, I think the discussion that you have on the table is the same. Which is same that you need if you want to talk on the screens. So it's a very important to talk physical with each other.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Georgios.
If I may answer your question, which I find extremely important and relevant. Thank you for trying to expand it and extend it to our methodology. As I mentioned, this was a project that we developed some years ago, and in the beginning, of course, the focus was on the on very specific details of the site and the architectural features of the intervention, as well as the process of really onboarding the stakeholders and those who would allow us to actually intervene on the public space. But in parallel to this activity, which was, as you saw, mostly solely focused on virtual reality technologies, we had already started considering how we could actually create, and this was the link to the cost action that, in the context of which we organized this this training school. The focus of the title of the cost action was cyber parks, and the idea is to use ICT tools to reactivate public space through mobile devices, etc. So through this activity, we had already started developing a plan for integrating in the physical side with beacons some information about the history of the site, as well as about the future visions or that the locals would have for their neighborhood, so that people could actually interact with information and with comments that other people would have left on site, geolocated through either a tagging system or the uploading of specific digital assets, in order to create a community that they would start a dialogue and they would discuss about this space. So definitely, yes, this is a very important aspect of the whole strands of the various strands of methodologies that we are developing in the lab, which include interaction, human interaction, and multiplayer, multi-user activities.
Wonderful, thank you very much. I do believe that this from this kind of encounters also between different projects that we want to foster through our platform of Public Play Space, as it is happening today, we have the possibility to keep investigating and also learning from each other. And this is something that is great. Rolf, Tessa, Georgios, again, thank you very much for being here, sharing your fantastic projects. And we will keep working on disseminating the great projects through the wiki platform. So we will want to know more also about the next development of your work. So thank you very much again.
We were honored. Thank you very much.
Pleasure. So we are now about to close this first day of the Public Play Space Symposium with a fantastic series of activities. I would like, first of all, to thank all the spectators, all the attendees that have been so active and so present throughout 5 intense hours. We know that an online activity is not easy to follow, and that's great to see such a great participation and such great activism. It's delightful for us. And of course, I would like to thank again all the speakers of the 3 different panels and the representative of the selected projects. Tomorrow, we are going to have another exciting day with the presentation of the papers selected through a call for paper that was launched at the beginning of March. So with this call, we selected different papers on the topic of serious game and on the topic of gamification interaction and community-based interaction. So these presentations will take place tomorrow. We will also share with you the visualization platform to have access to the projects that have been selected with the same call. So I will just now share with you one last information before we close, which is a deeper experience of our virtual exhibition. The virtual exhibition represents a key aspect of our project, is the dissemination and our dissemination strategy. I hope it can be visible. I don't know if Fiona or Raquel can confirm that.
Yes, it's visible.
Wonderful, thank you very much. So here you can see that in the virtual exhibition that is accessible from the website and also from the VPS and also from the link that we will share in the chat soon, you have the possibility to go through the virtual exhibition of our activities. So with a series of projects that we have developed throughout these 2 intense years and the state of the art catalog, as well as the 2 selected projects that we have been speaking about until now, but also the placemaking parade. The placemaking parade is the fantastic work developed and proposed also by our partner CLAC and collectively built on the visualization of placemaking experiences in the 3 partner cities. And eventually at the end, the wiki community platform. What is very important for us in the wiki community platform is that this is a platform open to everyone in the world that wants to share projects, can be their own projects or projects of other designers, about the topic of public play space, co-design of public space through new technologies and playful interaction and games. How to insert information can be done through this simple part. So add your own project. And from this part, easily it is possible to insert all the information following also our scheme and our categorization. So again, with this, I would like to thank you all. I will stop sharing and I would like like to remind you that tomorrow we will start again at 10. So thank you very much, and see you all tomorrow with the next and second and last day of the Public Play Space Symposium. Have a nice day.